now let's get back to the stage and welcome Marina, who's going to talk you more about the security practice that we have. So over to you, Marina.
Good afternoon, everybody. I hope you are enjoying our session so far. I am Marina. I am a technology specialist covering the security solutions, meaning everything that falls under E5 security and also the Azure security side of things. And today I'm going to walk you through the Ignite security updates that were announced. So let's get it started. I will start with the more general ones, and these are the naming updates that we had. And now the new namings are not new names, but they are actually trying to stress out and they are trying to address the multi-cloud capabilities that we have announced. So there are a few Azure solutions that now are moving to the Microsoft naming. We have Azure Sentinel, which is now Microsoft Sentinel. We have Azure Defender and Azure Security Center that are now unified into Microsoft Defender for Cloud. Azure Defender for IoT is now Microsoft Defender for IoT. And the last one, which is Microsoft Cloud App Security, is going to follow the same pattern with the other XDR solutions that are falling under the umbrella of Microsoft 365 Defender and is now going to be called Microsoft Defender for Cloud Apps. Now, these are the naming updates. Now we are going to speak a little bit about each and every solution and to see what is coming as new in their capabilities. Let's start with Microsoft Defender for Cloud. Now, Microsoft Defender for Cloud, as it is the new name, it's formally the combination of Azure Security Center and Azure Defender. And as mentioned, it's trying to address the multi-cloud capabilities. And this is actually leading to the first announcement, the first new feature, which is the native support for AWS. Now, we have implemented an agentless onboarding and agentless approach, leveraging the AWS API. Basically, we remove any dependency on the AWS services, such as the AWS Security Hub. And also, we are providing a single pane of glass for you to see the security recommendations, not only for the Azure security recommendations, but also for the AWS one, into Microsoft Defender for Cloud. Coming also with more than 160 out-of-the-box recommendations and the support for a few regulatory compliances such as CIS, PCI, and AWS Foundational Security best practices. Now, we are also extending the threat support for the Elastic Kubernetes services and for the EC2 instances. Now, having all the data into a cloud service, of course, it could be a very targeted place for the malicious actors as well. So I think it's really important for customers to firstly identify their sensitive data into the cloud, to prioritize it, and ultimately to secure it. And this is why we are announcing as well the Azure Purview integration, which is going to allow the customers to label the sensitive data into the cloud environments and to secure it. Now, some enhancements on the SIEM integration, which is Microsoft Sentinel right now, the formerly Azure Sentinel, in order to provide full visibility into the customer environment at a SIEM level. And those enhancements are actually the bidirectional sync between the two solutions, Microsoft Defender for Cloud and Microsoft Sentinel. And what do I mean by bidirectional? I mean that the state of the incidents and the state of the alerts are going to be synchronized between the two solutions. And also, another one at the SIEM level, enabling logging from recommendations page in Microsoft Defender for Cloud. All right, what is also important for a security analyst is to identify the potential risk, not only coming from the incidents or not only coming from the alerts that they are seeing, but also from the security recommendations that they are seeing in the portal. For this reason, we are now mapping the security recommendations as well to the MITRE ATT&CK framework. What does this mean to the analyst? It means that they are not only going to be able to see based on the category of the MITRE ATT&CK framework, but also to filter and to query based on the different techniques that are part of the framework. Lastly, but not least, it's the release of Azure Security Benchmark, the version 3, which comes with a few more regulatory add-on. Azure Security Benchmark is actually a collection of security recommendations for the most common compliance policies and standards. Now, this is it with Microsoft Defender for Cloud. Let's now go ahead and speak a little bit about the SOC area. We know that the job of a SOC analyst is not an easy job. So this is why we're coming with enhancements, which are mapped to the SOC lifecycle. So let's start with the first one, which is collecting the data, and not only collecting the data, but also bringing the visibility into what we are being able to collect. And the first one is the improved content hub, so that the app discovery and deployment is going to be easier. We are coming with more and more integrations. You can see already the number on the screen, 150 integrations, including some major ones such as SAP, IoT, OT, and XDR. Now, we know that every customer is different, so this is why we are trying to make everything as customized as possible. So we are allowing customers to bring their personalized content when it comes to CI/CD pipeline, API, and UX. Alrighty, the detection part right now, when hunting for the threats, we also know that looking at IOCs and looking at signatures is not enough, so this is why we need to expand our security and to look at user behavior, but not only at user behavior in general, but at your personal user behavior from your organizer. So really looking at the data from your environment in order to understand what is right, what could be malicious, or what could not be malicious. So new UAB anomalies based on your data. Also, we are announcing the integration with Azure Synapse, in which we are going to leverage the power of big data analysis and the machine learning models. And we know that for the SOC analysts, they actually are very interested into two metrics, right? Time to acknowledge and time to respond. For time to acknowledge, this is why we are trying to come into their help, and we are reducing the detection latency with near real-time analytic rules. Investigation part. If you are using Microsoft Sentinel, you are already using the fusion rules, which are basically correlating different events that are happening into your environment. We improved those fusion rules in order to provide even more context and also to prioritize the incidents that are resulted from the fusion rules. Let's go to respond. As mentioned, the second metric for a SOC analyst is time to respond. So again, a highly important aspect, and we are coming with some automation of Microsoft Dynamics security workflows, and also automatically enriching threat intelligence with GeoIP and GeoIP data. All right, now I would like to make an invitation to you, just to try it out. We do have some offers for Microsoft Sentinels in just up to 10 gigabytes per day for the first 31 days, or if you're already using Microsoft Sentinel, you can add it to your existing log analytics for free for the first 31 days. Now, the second offer that I would like to make is benefit of Sentinel over the E5 or A5 suite. You can save up to 1,050 USD per month with some free ingestion in Sentinel. All right, we spoke about Microsoft Defender for Cloud. We spoke about Microsoft Sentinel. Now let's have a look at Microsoft Defender for Cloud Apps, which is formerly MCAS. No new abbreviation for this name, so I'm just going to go with the long one. We have rebranded it, and it's now following the same pattern as the other solutions that are falling in under the Microsoft 365 suite, Defender for Endpoint, Defender for Identity, and Defender for Office. We are announcing the GA for app governance. We are adding more and more SaaS applications in the Microsoft Defender for Cloud Apps catalog, because this is really the power of a CASB solution to be able to understand and to interact with as many SaaS applications as possible. So now the number that we are speaking about is 26,000 applications in the catalog. and new integrations such as Slack, OneLogin, Zendesk, and Smartsheet. Last solution that I'm going to talk to you about is Microsoft Defender for IoT. It used to be called Azure Defender for IoT, and the name is not the only one that is changed. It's actually coming with a few enhancements. We are adding protection for enterprise IoT devices such as voice over IP, printers, badging. We are using passive monitoring. We are really trying to make it as easy as possible to deploy an IoT solution, a security solution, so that it doesn't have any performance impact and it doesn't interfere with your actual traffic. Now, we are working on the integration with Microsoft 365 Defender, so really bringing everything together when it comes to device inventory or to incidents and alerts. Now let's have a look, because I've already mentioned about no performance impact, no interfering with the traffic, and you probably are asking yourself, okay, but how is that possible? Because this is not really common when we speak about IoT security solutions. So let's have a look at the architecture of Microsoft Defender for IoT. So first, how can you bring data into Microsoft Defender for IoT portal? You have multiple options. The first one is on the left side of the slide at the bottom. If you're already using Microsoft Defender for Endpoint, if it's already deployed into your organization, then you can use that as a sensor for Microsoft Defender for IoT as well. Meaning, if you're already using Microsoft Defender for Endpoint, there is no need for you to install an extra agent, an extra deployment. You can just leverage the existing one from Microsoft Defender for Endpoint. Now, if there are parts of your organization that you don't want to deploy Microsoft Defender for Endpoint, or you can't deploy Microsoft Defender for Endpoint, there is another solution in order to bring the data into Microsoft Defender for IoT. And that is through a network sensor, which could be a virtual or a physical appliance. And what is really interesting here is that this appliance, this network sensor, is going to be connected to the spawn port of your network switch. Meaning, it will look at a copy of your data. It's going to be able to analyze to get the data from there without interfering with your actual traffic, which will mean for you no performance impact and no downtime for that. Still, the detection stays close to near real time. Now, the network sensor that you are seeing in the middle of the screen is not only collecting the data, it's also applying things like deep packet inspection at the layer 7, at the application layer, so really trying to understand what is happening into your network, and also finite machine state, which is really specific to the IoT and OT environment, and it has a reason for that, because the threats are specific and are different than the ones into the IT environment, so we really need to make sure that we leverage things like machine learning models and behavioral analytics that are really trained and especially for the IT and OT environment. Now, if you are already using an IoT platform, such as Zeek or Corelight, then you can bring those into Microsoft Defender as well through the integration that we support. All right, so these are the three options through which you can bring data, that you can bring data into Microsoft Defender for IoT. But what does it actually happen afterwards? Microsoft Defender for IoT is automatically providing you an asset inventory, meaning it's going to list all the IoT devices or OT devices that are present into a network, meaning what is the device type, what is the vendor, what is the IP address, what is the MAC address. And it will also start to draw the network topology between them. How do they really connect and how do they really speak to each other? It's going to check for vulnerabilities, so really looking for the CVEs that are connected to the devices that are checked, and is going to continuously monitor for threats. All right, I think that was it about Microsoft Defender for IoT. Now, another invitation for you, a few things that you can go either try out, either learn more about them. I'm going to leave the links here. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you're going to enjoy, because we still have the compliance part for you. Thank you very much, and have a great day.
Thank you so much, Marina, for this great session about our security practices. And we also have Gijs here at the table, who's our expert also on security. We got some questions, and just let me look them up, what the first question. Oh, great questions about some legacy systems, I see. Can I also protect my Windows 2000 R2 servers within this cloud service?
Which R2 servers? Is that 2012 R2?
2008, sorry.
2008 R2.
Yeah.
So we have support for 2008 R2. So through the Fenafor Cloud, you can absolutely protect 2008 R2. As long as if the operating system is supported, which is the case for 2008 R2, it's extended. So we are in the extended situation for with the ESUs. But anyway, it's still in a supported stage, and therefore we have capabilities to protect it either through the Fenafor Cloud as well as through the Fenafor endpoint. Absolutely, yeah.
And does it mean for all? If you want to the question added was example on how to onboard on-premise services toward Defender for Cloud. It can be for all on-premise services then.
As long as they are supported, we can onboard them through Azure Arc. Absolutely. So that's a capability to do that, or onboard them directly through installation of the Log Analytics agent to those devices.
Cool.
So I must say, depending on the operating system, we provide a different level of security capabilities. The more recent you are with your operating system, the more security capabilities will bring. But we are also providing security to the more older servers. I can give you the example of, for example, Windows Server 2012 R2 and Windows Server 2016. Those originally came not with our Defender antivirus solution, which is the underlying protection stack, of course, for our Defender for Cloud. But we are bringing those capabilities also to those operating systems, and therefore increasing security and bringing things like attack service reduction rules to those operating systems and bringing network protection to those server operating systems. So we are absolutely committed to protect all of the server workloads that are currently in support.
Yeah, cool, good to hear. Also a question about phishing attacks. Last week, somebody says here, last week I had a phishing attack within my organization, one of my employees. Can Defender help me to prevent this?
Absolutely. So Defender and Microsoft 365 Defender consists out of various solutions which work tightly together. And Defender for Office 365 is our main solution to prevent, protect, and detect these phishing campaigns, which means that we want to make sure that we apply the right threat policies. So in Defender for Office 365, we can configure threat policies to prevent phishing from actually entering the mailbox of a user. So that's our first line of defense. The second line of defense, because there's no 100% security, and that's why we need to build the layered security. The second layer of defense is actually where we detect anomalies. So for example, if a phishing mail got through, then we can detect anomalous behavior. For example, if the email is opened, Defender for endpoint kicks in and protects the end user from actually being successfully phished. Then Defender for Endpoint signals back the details to Defender for Office 365 to pick out all of the remaining emails out of the email boxes. We call that zero-hour auto-purge, which is another layer of defense. But there's more. In Defender for Office 365, we also have the phishing simulation, which means that we work towards increasing the human firewall. So phishing is not only having threat policies with preventing it, but it's also making sure that users can see if they are exposed to being phished. So that's why through these phishing simulations, we want to train our users to be better in not clicking malicious emails.
Yeah. That's a good thing, right? We're trying to it's not to trick you into things, but more educate you on the fact that what's going on.
Absolutely.
I think one of the key features to do this, you have must have a multi-factor authentication enabled to get these kinds of things, or you can do it with any login account or whatsoever, or is it?
So multi-factor authentication, if we talk about identity and if we talk about zero trust, then identity and multi-factor authentication is an important thing. If you look at one certain payload in phishing, which is a credential harvest campaign, that's a campaign where bad actors try to phish your credentials. And you can, of course, apply the protections that we've just discussed, but you can also make sure that you've put into play a multi-factor authentication so that if a user was successfully phished for whatever reason, then these harvested credentials cannot be reused and cannot be replayed to actually get access to the applications or resources of your organization.
Very cool.
So again, layered approach.
Yeah,
absolutely.
What I also see, I think we have this here at Microsoft. If I get like an email from an external person, I get like the tag external also. Yep. That's also helping me to digest basically, is this from an external person, yes or no? And to think about, okay, also you don't often receive email from this person. Is it also that something within the product that's...
Absolutely, yeah. I was discussing about Defender for Office 365 and the threat policies. If you follow the configuration analyzer in Defender for Office 365, we recommend you to set these threat policies in a certain configuration way. And if you follow these recommendations, then the threat policies will configure it in such a way that you will get these messages, so that you will understand whom you're communicating with on a regular basis. And if you get an email from someone outside of that barrier, you will get the policy tips, you'll get the notifications, for example, that you're now communicating with someone you're usually not communicating with, which increases the alert, hopefully, of a user and reduces the risk of being phished.
Sounds great. another thing is about Siemens SOC. We heard about it. We got also smaller companies. And the question is, I'm not a big company. I have 50 people working for me. Do I need to invest in things like a SOC or a SIEM or whatsoever? To get myself safe. Mm-hmm. What's our advice?
So, you know, having a SOC is having that end-to-end visibility across all of the components of your digital estate. So if your organization is using various different digital estate technologies, like a firewall, like a proxy, like endpoint protection, like phishing protection, like ransomware protection. You want to kind of combine all of these security events in a central place that have that end-to-end visibility of your organization. So there's no black and white answer. So it's a gray area. But I think that as an organization, you want to have that end-to-end digital visibility. But if you're a small organization, you don't have the resources to invest in a 24/7 security operations center with security analysts. And therefore, we have a great partner ecosystem that is providing these services. So the MSSPs, the partners that actually provide these security solutions, they often run on the Microsoft security stack. So these partners can provide you these technologies so that you'll have the end-to-end visibility and that you will protect it on that level. So I would definitely encourage you to invest in this. And if you don't have the resource yourself, seek the help of the partner ecosystem. Absolutely.
Yeah, I think that's a good advice. And what we see right now, and I come from the partner ecosystem, we see a lot of people, a lot of partners now jumping into this space and looking at how can I provide that kind of service for my customers? Because especially when they are smaller, it's really difficult to get into play and giving them the opportunity to be safe, because security nowadays is more than ever a hot topic.
Absolutely.
And things are going wrong. Another question we have here is about what's the difference between Microsoft Defender for Cloud and Microsoft Defender for Cloud Apps?
Great question.
Okay.
I can imagine that it's only one word, Defender for Cloud, Defender for Cloud Apps. I think Defender for Cloud is really focused to protect your infrastructure. So Defender for Cloud is really aimed to protect your virtual machines. It's really aimed to protect your databases, your application services, whether they are in Azure, whether they are in another cloud, or whether they are on premises through a hybrid situation. So Defender for Cloud focuses on protecting the infrastructure. Defender for Cloud Apps really focuses on three main topics. First of all, detect shadow IT. So what kind of applications you're using that are not aligned with your security policy. So for example, if you've decided as organization to use OneDrive for sharing of your files and storing of your files, then you probably want to know if your employees are using Box, and then maybe educate them to use a company-approved application. So that's the first use case for Defender for Cloud Apps. The second use case is really about information protection, so understanding the flow of your sensitive information through cloud apps and providing the right security and the right protection once the data goes into other cloud applications. And third is about threat protection. So making sure that if you're using these applications that you know, okay, do I maybe have overexposure through OAuth? Do I maybe have malware in these applications? Is maybe malware stored over there? So those are the three main areas of Defender for Cloud Apps. So two completely separate things, but two very important parts if you want to have the full end-to-end security for your organization.
Okay. Talking about that, also, does it detect, you can say like every application that you don't want, you can block them. Let's say the IKEA Keukenplanner, or what's like the biggest application everybody has, right?
And everyone needs.
Everyone needs a Keukenplanner, of course. You can say then block these kinds of applications from your managed device?
Yes. What you can do is, and that's a nice thing of the integration, and once you have deployed Defender for Endpoints to your devices, then you can also enable Shadow IT discovery. And I think Marina explained very clearly that we currently have evaluated the risk of over 26,000 SaaS applications.
Wow.
So for each of that application, we have looked into, okay, what is actually the risk of using it? From a legal perspective, from a technical perspective, from an organization that's behind it perspective. So where is the data stored? Does the SaaS application apply to GDPR regulations? Is there an ISO certification behind this organization? So we evaluate these applications on up to 90 risk factors. And then as an organization, you can apply governance on top of it. So these are the applications that have been detected. This is the risk score. Okay, yeah. Let's decide if we should allow this application for my organization, yes or no.
Yeah. So we hope now that the IKEA Keukenplanner is one of the 26,000 that we have checked.
And if it's not, then in the portal you can request Microsoft to add the application and also request Microsoft to apply a risk score to these applications. Yeah.
Another question on this, you talk about Microsoft Defender for Endpoint, we're talking about also that kind of stuff. If I want to deploy this, do I need like a VPN, or how do I deploy this to my, let's say, bring your own device systems for that matter?
If you want to deploy what?
Defender for Endpoint.
Defender for Endpoint.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. or do you want to take the stage for a bit?
No, I just wanted to make clear whether we're talking about Defender for Cloud Apps still or Defender for Endpoint. But
yeah.
It's for you, Gijs.
Yeah, okay, I'll take it. So I think there are two questions in that question. The first question is about, do I need a VPN? Second question is about bring your own device. So because on a bring your own device, you usually don't manage the device, you don't have a VPN on those devices, usually. But let's split it up into two questions. The first question is about VPN. Do I need VPN for the Microsoft security solution? And the answer is no. I think that we as an organization are actually advocating to user solutions without VPN. And the reason for that is with VPN, you're actually often not applying with one of the zero trust principles, because zero trust mentions verify explicitly.
Yeah.
And if you establish a VPN connection, then you verify once. And after you have authenticated to the VPN connection, you can just go behind the VPN and access any application in the organization. So it's absolutely not aligned with our zero trust principles. So we recommend even not to use VPN, I think, and it's not needed at all. So Defender for Endpoint, Defender for Office 365, Defender for Cloud Apps, Defender for Identity, all these applications work flawlessly without a VPN. Same applies for Azure AD, same applies for Endpoint Manager, same applies for all of the information protection and compliance capabilities. No VPN needed at all. Second part of the question is, what about bring your own device? And I think there we get back into the story of identity. So if you want to leverage the security capabilities on a bring your own device, then you have to log in into these SaaS solutions. And as you log in into a SaaS solution, being Office 365, being your corporate application, doesn't really matter. If you log in, you're logging in with the Azure AD identity provider. And that's the point when we can start to apply controls over access to the application, over the session, and we can control, okay, am I actually allowed to access the application on my bring your own device?
Yeah.
And if I'm allowed to access the application, I can control the session, and I can make sure that I, for example, read all of the things, but am not allowed to download any of the corporate data on my bring your own device, which makes sure that that users can be productive, but are aligned with being compliant and preventing any data leak from happening. So very pretty powerful solution, if you ask me.
Absolutely, and what I really love, and I have it on my own device, I have an Android device as a mobile device, it's like split in two. I got my personal stuff and I got my work stuff, and they are not able to get into each other's world. And that's really cool to see, if I do. And one other cool thing I think about it is I can disable my work profile. So for the weekend, I was away and I go like, well, I don't want to be bothered by Teams or Outlook or whatsoever. I just press the button on top and you go like, disable the working profile. Really love that stuff. So really powerful stuff around Defender. And it's good to see that we all bring it together with the new rebranding. It's now called Microsoft Defender and then else. And that's, I think it's a good idea, right? To bring it all together. We see that Microsoft really has a security entity. We do a lot around security and bringing this together is really cool.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think we're on a best of suite approach. But in the meantime, our solutions are also best of breed, I think.
Yeah.
But I think we're on a long journey here, or at least we have been on a long journey. And I think we're starting to get into a situation where we really see the best of suite, the best of integration.
Yeah.
Previously, we had different portals for Defender for Endpoint, Defender for Office, Defender for Identity. They don't exist anymore. They were all combined into one single portal, security.microsoft.com. That's where all of your security stuff happens.
Cool. Thank you so much, Gijs, for these clear answers. Now let's get back to our presentation. Anella is going to talk to us.